your previous unsuccessful attempt this semester were not successful at starting
Thank you. Pleasure to be here. So these lectures will be about interaction of representation theory and algebraic geometry. So maybe I'll start with a brief philosophical introduction. So what is representation theory? So it started symmetries of linear mathematical structures. And well, so formally it's a branch of algebra. I'll give a more formal definition of this. But one may wonder why. I mean, it's a valid algebraic question, but why is it so more interesting than any other algebraic question you can ask? And now humans have been attracted to symmetry called linear, and also, I mean, architecture, and so it's obviously somehow satisfying for us to see symmetric structures, but also humans try to use symmetry to explain the universe. So, for example, Plato in his famous dialogue sometime in the 4th century BC, try to explain the elements of which the world is made by relating them to platonic solids. So Earth was corresponding to cube and etc. So try to remember to everyone. And there are two more. Water and fire. Corresponding to icosahedron. and tetrahedron. Well, that's of course just mystical speculation from modern perspective, but in the last 2 centuries, more substantial results in this direction have been achieved. And so it actually turns out that, in fact, so after Galois, in all of that symmetries in whole algebra, things in algebra, and then after Schrödinger, Heisenberg, and other founding fathers of quantum mechanics, well, the symmetries can control the world of elementary particles. And then well, Langlands program basically tells us that the way is somewhat similar role in number theory, and I hope to see in my lifetime symmetries playing a similar role in algebraic geometry. So I hope this is the next step, and well. And again, I'm not talking about straightforward understanding of this idea. I'm not talking, of course, there are great varieties with symmetries, but these are sort of exceptions. I'm not talking, that would be like looking for microscopic objects with symmetry in the physical world. Of course, there are some, but not so many. I'm talking about some hidden symmetries controlling the structure of this type. Okay, so this is all philosophy I have to present. And so getting closer to the actual subject matter. So in the title, there is this purification. So, representations are symmetries, and again, so representation. Okay, maybe that's a formal definition of the group, the algebra, associative algebra, etc. is just an action of that thing. It's action on a vector space. These days, it's fashionable to talk about, there has been some progress in understanding the higher symmetries. So you have symmetries, and then you can see the symmetries of symmetries. Manifestation of this principle here is that representations themselves form a category, so representations. Given thing, algebra, etc., form a category, so there are those morphisms, symmetries of this representation. As we'll see already today, various numerical questions. About representations can be phrased in terms of numerical invariance of that category. And so moreover, so so that category sometimes has a sort of counterpart one categorical level down. And relating to a new vector space, which holds key to questions about those representations. So the most concrete, but not the most general way to say what this vector space is, the vector space V and for example one can set so can V to be just the growth integral of C. So representations form a abelian category, and so this is the group spanned by objects in C modulo the relation that M1 is a class represented by an object M1 is the sum of classes represented by objects on 2M and M3 if we have a short exact sequence. So as a vector space, this is actually an abelian group, and then this is one way to get this vector space, V should be something like it, should be that or something related to it. And then in some contexts, sort of oftentimes, we can start with B, and then we can look for C related to it in this way, which would be its fitting unification. And the pattern we're going to discuss is that so if it's just a vector space, I mean, there's not much you can do with it. But V in turn oftentimes turns out to be to have more structure. Again, I'm just describing a pattern. So for examples, turns out to have more structures, in fact, for example, it can itself be a representation of some new algebraic object. So this, okay, so this will hopefully become more concrete soon. Okay, so and then just want to count for this word geometric in the title. So I was talking, I said that representations are linear algebraic structures, and we want to connect them to algebraic geometry. So we should recall that in algebraic geometry, people work with linear invariants. That's actually the theorem of motifs. So, linear invariants of an algebraic variety. That's the primary algebraic consideration in algebraic geometry. Well, there are many such, but for example, you can take cohomology. You have algebraic variety X over C. Or if you start with X over a finite field, you can take the finite set of its FQ points. And you can take the space of functions on that. That's certainly also this and linear invariant of your variety. And well, these linear invariants, they come with some categorical counterparts. So, and again here you will see can be categorized. I mean, you can see why I didn't want to say that V is necessarily the cross integral that's just related to it. But there are categories which are definitely related to it. So there is, for example, a category of vector bundles, perfect complexes on X in this setting. Or the human sheaves on X. And we do have a short character map for K0 for the exact category of vector bundles to cohomology of X, for the coherent sheaves to parallel homology. So these are vector spaces are related to those categories in that way. And likewise, there is a famous trace of Frobenius. construction which sends this it's a map received by this vector space going from the head of a large machine. X, well, there I used an isomorphism. So this is what I would mean by geometric integration example, such as in talk about other examples later. So I would argue, side remark that the space of, say, L2 functions, so C is in this sense, has a categorification, which is the category of the modules of X, but okay, so this is, don't assume that this writes a familiar talk about it. Okay, so yeah, and basically the example point is that there are many examples when one can relate several theorems. Relating the two types of purification that is indicated. Because that's, yeah, maybe I should have mentioned this, that in this geometric story, the vector spaces do come with an additional structure, for example. In this case, comes with Hodge structure somehow. This gives a lot of mileage. If you relate your algebraic purification to geometric one, this gives you tools to study algebraic properties. Okay, and so so now I want to get more concrete, and so just to briefly describe so Cardano's conjectures. So I will not state the conjectures today. I will, but probably next time I will do that and indicate the main ingredients of the proof. So this is there is actually a conjecture stated around maybe 79, and proved soon thereafter. So, 81 by Benson Bernstein. And Brian Pashavara. This is a motivating example for many perhaps the first example in this direction, and so so I want to discuss that. So today again I will explain what the problem is about. And I will describe the main geometric ingredients. Okay, so I told you there will be some algebraic geometry. So we some algebraic varieties, and I will describe the standard algebraic varieties that appear in this game. So later in these lectures, hopefully more interesting algebraic varieties such related to modular spaces. bundles on curves, shapes on surfaces, and things like that will appear. So today it will be more modest, so there will be all the right to turn the direction. So let's just slide this up. So now I start with so G will be a semi-simple algebraic group. G will be Lie algebra, so I'll assume the basic structural theory, although I want to assume the much presentation theory, but so you can take G just S, L, and C, and then want anything you think about this example. And so, does this thing look like? So it has a compound subalgebra and this triangular decomposition. So G is M plus E plus N minus of the vector space. So this would be diagonal matrices. One of the classical objects of study is the one to understand what's called highest weight modules, but so there's a term. So modules. I mean, one can pretty well understand finite dimensional modules. And I'll remind how that goes. And some of the what I will describe now is a reasonable class of infinite dimensional modules. So the a general infinite dimensional module is a sort of wild object, but this is a reasonable class of modules. And so the there is a non term that or there is a term introduced by Benson, Galfon, Galfon. Bernstein, Galfon, Galfon. Okay, but if not the term, the definition is a general initial, so you consider modules which are finitely generated. And where n acts locally importantly and t acts locally finitely, you can just say that b is finite.
Over
the enveloping object. And t acts locally finitely. In fact, sometimes we want to require that TX, the action of T is diagonalizable.
So what do you mean by locally finitely?
So if you take any vector and look what it generates, it's fine. And so every such module M can be decomposed as a sum of M mu, and so these are generalized eigenspaces, homology spaces in final CT. So. And if you look at how T acts, so this nu is a linear function on T, and so that's called the weight. And then you can actually quickly classify irreducible modules. So facts. So first, all objects are finite length. These are easy consequences of the definitions. M of mu is finite dimensional. Yeah, and then maybe I'll give a quick example of an object in this category. So again, so so basically, n acts often importantly. So you know, if you add by many elements in n, you get zero, and so it's natural to look at the vectors killed by n. And so I just this is just an object. So the Verma module is a definition. Module with highest weight lambda. It's just induction is defined as n lambda. It's induction from B to G of, well, again, C lambda. So what's going on here? So we just take a one-dimensional space. I mean, the group of upper triangular matrices is, of course, the algebra. It's also, of course, solvable. So we can, so it has many one-dimensional modules where n acts by zero and t acts by a fixed character, just linear, arbitrary functional. And then you can take this module and use u of g and u of v of lambda. And the structure of this module as a vector space is pretty clear just from quantum and from W theorem. It's clear that the action map gives an isomorphism to enveloping alpha n minus. Free module over n and over n broken minus will write by that one vector. So each vector from this highest weight generating vector by actually a unique action of a unique element developing n minus. Okay, so I will something. Doing something. But yeah, and so I just want to hold fact three that M lambda has a unique irreducible quotient. And these are all irreducible objects in this category. Okay, and so so, for example, finite-dimensional modules are obviously lie in this category, and so they should be on this list, and of course they do. And so, example, so L lambda is finite-dimensional if and only if. Lambda is what's called integral and dominant, or integral and positive. Means that so it's a linear function of Parton, but then it takes so lambda charges and then negative integer for all simple points. So for SLN, you can weight as a n tuple of numbers modulo. Adding the same number to all of them, and so GXLM. So power is P to the M modulo C. And so these weights correspond to the set of vectors with integer non-increasing coordinates. Okay, and so yeah, so first a bunch of problem and then some comments. So these conjectures, they generalize the famous wild character formula. So a few words about. So so we want to understand. Characters. These are formal since yeah, this maybe is equivalent to understanding the dimensions of the space of the weight spaces. So characters in this setting, they're just formal generating functions. So character of any object M in our category is a sum of dimension of N mu. So this is a formal, so it's an element in a formal completion of the completion. It's a formal character, which is an element in the completion of the group ring so we and for finite dimensional modules is obviously it's almost equivalent to just understanding the trace, computing the trace of every element of the group, FT, in this representation. But in general, with infinite dimensional representations, they don't integrate to the representation of the group. It's still here. Okay, and so so just some remarks. So first, character of a Verma module M lambda is very easy to compute. So this is an exercise just from this isomorphism. Character of M lambda is something like equal to something like e to the lambda product of alpha, which is positive root, 1 minus e to the minus alpha. And yeah, you can do this exercise even if you don't know the structural theory, it's just corresponding. Write down. I mean, it's just a character that's symmetric. U of N minus of course the vector space is the same. Okay. And so maybe I should remind the famous wild character formula. And it can be written in several different forms, and it has can be related to geometry in several different ways. Besides one of them. And so if lambda is integral positive, so that lambda is dimensional, then the character of a lambda is sum over the well group. So okay, it didn't yet, yes, make an appearance, but of course the well group is just a symmetric group of all letters. So it'll be minus 1 to the power of the limit level, so it's just a parity of the permutation.
Is there a Roman? Is the spectrum of the maximal torus on something in category O? Does it act? Is the spectrum discrete?
Of course, yes. So yes. So in fact, this is kind of immediate from. Well, for example, from the fact that irreducible the portions of Verma, you know. So there is some highest weight, and the only weights which appear are of the form that weight minus some combination of coefficients. And yeah, that's good. Right. Okay, so yes, and so there will be E, so there was a numerator and denominator, and so okay, then we'll just write dot lambda, and this is divided. Actually, let me just write this character of the Verma module of w dot lambda. So where w dot lambda, so this is the wild group which acts on weights, but then, so in this game, our we just need to shift the center of this action to away from zero,
then this is done with the scroll, when our void is after some positive weights.
I mean, substituting the formula for the character of Namdi, you get the actual cost. So Castellanistic formula is another formula of so it will roughly have the same shape, so it will say that character of L lambda is sum of the characters of some Bermer modules, and there will be some multiplicities and the new, but since we have closed formula for Bermer modules, the point is to describe those integers. And as I said, this all would be related to geometry, so maybe right, well, let me say right away what sort of geometry is related to. So the favorite algebraic variety of representation theory is a flat variety, so I recall that G has a maximum proper homogeneous space. Compact in the classical topology of continuous space. Which is the quotient G modulo B. I will call it B, skin B. So for G less the lambda, this is of course the variety of complete flats. This is just a description of orbits of B on B mod B, or what's the same relative position of two flats. So the orbits of B on strip B, or what's the same G orbits on B square. So this is relative. So each orbit is called a Schubert cell, and so V union, straight union, V double, so Schubert cells. Yeah, so for SLM, this is just saying that an invertible matrix can be decomposed as a, by row and column, well, can be decomposed as a product of upper triangle times permutation times another triangle, which is something you know from the algebra. And yeah, so each B double is in a finite space.
And so to connect various things that have been said, I just want to say that a wild character formula can be obtained as a categorification of an obvious equality says that constant function on the flag variety value 1, well, if it, it can be decomposed as a sum W terms, which are characteristic functions of various Schubert sets. Okay? So this is my notation for this characteristic function. And it's okay. It's going on here, so of course the characteristic, if a set is composed and it is joint building of subsets, then the characteristic function is a sum of characteristic functions of subsets. But, well, so the remarkable point is that, so anyway, you can see, so there are W terms here and W terms there, but the question is how to connect the Verma model of these characteristic functions, so that I'll talk about the subsequent lectures. And so I was going to talk about other things, maybe about geometry, other aspects of geometry related to this problem. So maybe before doing that, I should give an example, just to get some feeling for what's going on. And unfortunately, all this problem is trivial in this case, so we won't get much feel for the difficulty of the problem, but it is worth it. So, okay, so then G has a basis, E, F, and H. So, and then, okay, so how does the Verma model look like? So, well, in this case, it looks like just symmetric algebra in one term. Lambda is just a number because T has his one dimensional in this space is H. And so M lambda, it has a structure, so whole weight spaces are one dimensional, so the, it has a basis maybe V0, V1, etc. So these are sort of weight subspaces. And down. And so you can choose a basis so that HVI is lambda minus 2i because and so FVI is lambda plus 1. Okay, so where did I get this from? So I mean, this is just saying that it's a free module of the modules in F. And then for I equal to 0, so V0 is my generator. So basically, this is my generator, and the relations are that E kills it, and HV0 is equal to lambda. This is one of my defining relations. And the for other I, it follows from this, because I give values, of course, N, you know, just from Jacobian identity. And in fact, HF is minus 2F. We have this equality.
Hans VI, right?
Yes.
and then there is some calculation to do.
Namely, it's clear from weight consideration that if you write compute EVI, then it's some CI, that is VI minus 1.
But this constant CI has to be calculated from the by induction. So basically, we know that just from the equality that EF minus FE VI is equal to lambda minus VI. And then I plug in, and then I get that CI plus 1 minus CI is lambda minus 2I. And so C minus 1 is 0, so C 0 is lambda. And so Cn is maybe n times lambda minus 1. If I didn't make a mistake, but okay. But so what does this formula tell us? That there are basically two different cases. So if lambda is not, I mean, one thing is whether this can be zero. If lambda is not a positive integer, then this never is never zero, and then my modulus is irreducible. So that's, you can use every vector generates it. But if this can be zero, then this vector for which it is zero generates a proper submodule, and then we get something like this. Now, and so if lambda is minus 1 for a negative integer, then m lambda contains m minus lambda minus 2. And that's basically the so we start with some n, and then we go minus n and steps. So now I'm writing the weights. And then there will be, here there will be what's called singular vector. It's q by e, so it generates a proper submodule, the quotient, and you get a finite dimensional representation. And so this is kind of the end of the story in this case, but this explains that at least one general feature that illustrates is that the most interesting things happen when lambda is integral. And so similar considerations show that for any g, if lambda is generic, then m lambda is irreducible and nothing is happening. Okay, so maybe it's about time to stop. So it's about an hour, yeah? So
3:34.
Yeah, so should I jump for an hour or should I jump? I can take another like 10, 15 minutes. So, so there are two things I want to do. So I want to first explain the following point, that this problem is about category 5 categorization of the wild group or of the space of functions on the wild. So let me explain why. So another standard feature is decomposition of
HP or in blocks. So there is this, we have the center, resolving algebra that takes the invariant part. Chandra, for example, the GSL 2, then this thing contains subalgebra generated by Casimir elements, so C is equal to EF plus FE plus H squared 2. And well, we can commute it with any element. Let's see. We get H, so this is indeed a central element, and similarly if I have H. And you can also compute actually how it acts on all these models. So it's clear that. That it has to act by scalar on, say, Verma module, because it's generated by it's preserved, of course, all central element preserves all weight space, and that's what scalar does on this one dimensional weight space of the highest weight vector, and then since it commutes with the action of all operators on the Lie algebra, it does scalar on the whole module. And so the C can be, so how it has come down the well, we just compute. So we just compute how it acts on the highest weight vector. So E kills it, and F, what F E does to it, we just compute it. And so it's equal to lambda plus lambda squared over 2 times identity. And one of the features that there is this lambda, it's kind of even function, but even where the center is placed at minus one, that can also be that also is related to this embedding, because it's clear that if we have a non-zero, like two modules where this operator acts by scalar and have a non-zero map, then the scalar has to be the same, and so my polynomial has to take the same value. And so in general, which already explains kind of where this action comes from. I need to introduce this shift by raw somewhere. Maybe I introduce it here. So I can either say that this is the standard action, but then there will be this shift by raw when I explain how this central element act on M lambda. But so maybe I introduce it here. So this is the dot action. So it's just the usual action that shifted from center minus rho. And then, so this is actually, sorry, it's, if this is algebraic function, this function is only dual. And then solve that for polynomial. Two reducible representations for which the those scales are different, there are no extensions, and just in case this please do that sum. So then this will be characters of this algebra, so there will be points of this function variety. And along the lines of what I just explained, let's take some most interesting case. Summons correspond to lambda being integral and the regular. So regular just means that it's a free down in the orbit. So for example, it's the sum of the trivial representation. Or actually any, yeah, this condition is actually equivalent to saying that the sum is containing a finite dimensional. So if we fix such a summons, so such summons and bijection. So if it's an integral regular weight, we can uniquely conjugate it to a dominant weight. So in bijection with lambda of this expectation, so it's plus again, so dominant. And so all, say, gamma modules, so that's lambda, so it contains m lambda, mu, so fixes lambda, and so where mu is w dot lambda, and so so both these sets give a basis in the cross integral. And so this base manifests the index by double. And And so Cartan's problem is equivalent to understanding the transformation matrix from one basis to another. Between the two bases. And so, in fact, the good way to set things up is to identify a norm of 4 lambda with the group ring of the wild group by sending W to it's an annoying sign, but basically the class of m dot w dot lambda, where lambda is a positive thing. And so then the question is, describe the other basis. So for example, for SL2, you just get the other basis, and so it consists of one. Standard base consists of one in S, and this other basis will consist of, in my conventions, of maybe S and one minus S. So the term for this is canonical basis, but the meaning of this was a term which appears a lot in this theory. The meaning I'll explain next time. So I described the setup, and maybe next time I'll talk about geometry and this story.
So what is the role played by the BGG resolution?
Yes, you can of course deduce this quality in the form that I stated from the BGG.
But there is another role played by this?
Yes, you can say that I would say that BGG resolution is a sort of quantification of this equality that I wrote. But maybe I'll talk a bit about it later in the lecture.
So what is sort of the goal of the course? What is it all leading up to?
Yes. So. Well, I just want to, the goal is to link representation theory to algebraic geometry, but more concretely, I'll talk about ideas from geometric language. Homological mirror symmetry, enumerative geometry, quantum cohomology that illustrate this build up from where I started. Thanks for the question. I actually meant to say this, but got carried away.
So, no other questions? Okay, let's thank the speaker again.